Welcome to another Lightblade Learning Lab. In today's session, we're going to make a new addition for this machine. Now, I've been advised that quite a few people are having trouble with their either Bofa or their Purex filter unit when they're cutting MDF. The debris and the smoke has been quite heavy and they're blocking their filters up quickly. I've been asked to look at the possibility of copying somebody else's pre-filter. Well, I'm afraid that's in itself a bit of a challenge because I don't like copying other things. There's a problem. I like to think about the problem and try and find a cost-effective solution. So that's what I've done. Hopefully I'm going to make a very simple, cost-effective pre-filter for this machine that will be easily either replaceable or washable, which is the ultimate goal. You don't have to ever buy new filters. What I'm going to do is dive straight in and cut the pieces, and then we'll put them together and see how the thing works.
Now, I'm making this out of nominally 5mm perspex. It's white perspex, which I just happen to have some spare of. So it's whatever it is. But you could make it out of 5mm plywood or 5mm MDF. I don't think it really matters. Now I'm using a 2-inch lens on here, and I'm cutting this at maximum power and running at, I think, about 8mm a second. Well, there's our first piece is cut. And all the pieces are just falling apart, which is very nice. And yeah, they fit in there nicely. It only just about fits on the table. I think it's about 395 or 398 back to front. So yeah, this was a tight squeeze to fit this onto the table. Okay, now my second piece of material that I'm going to be cutting is big enough to do the job, but it's a very odd shape, as you can see underneath here. So what I've done, I've purposely cut my first piece out of a nice square item where I can see exactly where it's going to go. And now what I'm going to do is to register where the start point is and make sure that this aperture fits over the material. So I now know that the cut is going to fit onto that piece of material there. And here we have the last part cutting, and yes, it's going to come out of that funny shape. And there we go, that's all fallen out nicely. Even all those little 3mm holes. If you're making a wood, you might well be putting just ordinary wood screws or some self-tappers in these little pilot holes. I'm going to tap them M4. Up to now, I've purposely been trying to hide what I'm going to do. We're going to start showing you now how things work. Now look, these two pieces here have got some interesting cutouts in them. These cutouts here are flexible tongues. They're quite stiff, but they do flex. And the idea is that these two pieces clip together like this, and then they will actually go in that extract tube at the back there, and they'll go in easily until they reach those little barbs, when I shall have to go and push it in. So once the whole thing is assembled, that will sit snugly in there, but you'll be able to take it out. So that begins to give you a little bit of a clue as to what I'm trying to do. Now we go and build the next part. Well, here are the 8 parts that are going to make up this filter. Now I need to assemble them in the right manner. So I need to start with that one. And as I said, these cross over and they will poke through there like that. They are quite loose, but that's because this material can vary anything from 4.5 to nearly 6mm. So it's incredibly difficult to get these holes to fit perfectly. I made the holes 4.7. Knowing that quite a lot of this material was undersized, but I came across some stuff that was nearly 6mm. So I think the first thing we'll do is to pop this piece on. We'll glue it on first, and we'll glue it on from this side. So using my
PETG glue, which seems to work extremely well on acrylic. Now, I'm not going to be too fussy about the glue this time because nobody's going to see this piece. Okay, so it sits nicely on my box now. I can put just another little bit of glue along the bottom corners here as well. I mean, this is an incredibly simple assembly. What we're now going to do is just drop that on there like that. These are all exactly the same, and they just work their way round nose to tail. Like that. Now, if I've got all these bits designed correctly, this bit will now sit on top here. And there we go, that's the complete assembly. So all I've got to do now is to go around and just glue these joints. And the whole thing will be almost finished. Just give these another few minutes to dry, another minute or so. Then I can turn the whole thing over and I can finish off the tabs underneath. And then just to make sure it's nice and really strong, I'm going to run a bead of glue right around the edges. And when that's dry, I should do this edge here as well. But I should wait for that to fully dry before I assemble the last parts. Well, here we are next day, and I've just been and bought what I thought were going to be the ideal thing to fit on there. That's what I designed. And they're these things, which are standard computer filters. And their plan was to just stack 9 of those up. But now that I've got them, and I take them apart and have a look at the filter material, look, you can see it's probably pretty next to useless. It's probably fine for taking lumps of sugar out the air, but not for very fine particles of MDF smoke. So, plan A, in the bin. But fortunately, I always did have a plan B when I designed this. But plan B involves making a few more pieces. Now, I didn't have enough material to make that in one piece, so I had to make it in two pieces. But what we're going to do is we've got these extra pieces as well. So let's make sure we get them all the same way, because there's a long end and there's a short end, as you can see. So I need all the long ends working the same way so that I can put them in long end, long end, that way. We should just turn that over and assemble that the other way, because I can't glue it this way. Okay, so now we'll just pop some glue on those and get that held together. Now, the most important thing at the moment is probably these joints here, because goodness me, that's raining outside, I can just hear it. So I should just hold those two joints together. Just make sure they press together. And then I should be able to just gently put a little bit of stuff along those joints there to get those to bond together. Right, so now that we've got that upside down, we'll just do what we normally do and just run round all these joints here just to make sure that we've got them nice and strong. Ah, well, okay. What's it cost us so far? Some design time and either some MDF and maybe a few screws. Now, screws are an interesting thing, because I happen to have some very nice M4 plastic screws, which is why I designed these holes at M4, because look, I've got a bag of these that's been kicking around for about 20 years. So I have to find a use for them sometime. When my other filter system failed, I went to a store, which I'm sure you've all come across, called Dunelm. Now, it's not the sort of place you'd normally go for engineering equipment, but look what I've got. For £4, I've bought a meter, and it's material that they use for quilting. But look, it's absolutely amazing. It's exactly what we're looking for by way of a filter material. And look, I've got all this, a metre of it, for £4. So that's the only real cost of this project. And I've got enough there to make probably 6 filters, or replace the filter that's in here 6 times, whichever way you like to look at it. See, I don't think it has to be cut all that accurately, because it's sufficiently flexible that it will push inside my frame here. And if it doesn't, well, I'll just trim it off. Looks as though it might need a little bit of a trim, but no big deal. Now, I've made this dimension here 10 millimetres thick, but this looks to be about probably 12 to 15 millimetres thick, so it will squash down. You've only got to increase this by another 10 or 20 millimetres, and you can put 3 or 2 thicknesses of this material in there. I mean, it's just literally almost invisible to airflow. What I'm going to have to do is just trim the corners off, just to clear my screw holes, because I think I'm only going to need the 4 corners to hold this on. And my over-enthusiastic use of holes is not in the least bit necessary. That works perfectly okay with just 4 corner screws. Now, what you've got to remember is that each one of these holes is the same size as the extract duct. So the velocity of air, or volume of air, through these holes will be 1/9 of what it is down the extract duct. So there's virtually no air resistance through this filter at all. So because there's so little pressure loss across here, you won't need an additional extract motor. You can use the fan that's already there, which is why this will just disappear in the machine and it will be seamless. Now, this is so relatively cheap to make, you could technically have 2 of these, so that one of them is in your machine and the other one is out being replaced. But it's only going to take, what, 20 minutes to take this out of the machine and put a new filter in it? Okay, well, let's take a look in the machine and see where we're going to fix this now. You had a bit of an idea because you saw me trying this little piece at the back here. This is very asymmetric, so we've got to fit it in one way only, and it goes in this way. But we have to be careful because at the top here, there's a bit of a ridge. And so what I've got to do, I've got to put it in basically flat like that, get it beyond the ridge, and then tip it upright. And that will then get me past this belt. There we go, it's clicked into place. And you can now see the reason why I've got that little foot there, just to keep it level. We'll just turn the extract system on to make sure that the filter doesn't go and suck in. Now, I'm just going to do a 25 millimeter test square on some it's hardboard, which is sort of MDF type material. We can see the fumes being drawn backwards. That cut can go a lot faster because it smells smoky.
It smells smoky and it looks smoky, and look, it's leaving marks on my hand. Just clean my fingers. Still a little bit of, but not as bad. Let's try pushing it a little bit more. 22 maybe, or 24? Let's try 24. It hasn't dropped out, but it will pop out. And now, let's try a clean finger. There we go. 24. Maybe it would go to 26. Only just making it. Look, let's push the bottom out now. So that is not a good cut. Looks to be about 24 millimeters a second is a good speed to go for. But the whole point there was we're trying to generate some smoke. Now I doubt whether I've generated anywhere enough smoke to see anything on the filter, but let's have a look. Well, I don't know where it's come from, but we've definitely got some bits of debris on these two here, which is approximately under where we were dragging the fumes from. So this is something that I think will have to be field tested by somebody that uses a lot of MDF all day. Well, I hope you found that another interesting session. A practical problem and a practical solution. I've enjoyed the design challenge, and I think we've come up with something which is very cost effective and simple for virtually anybody to adapt and fit. As I mentioned earlier, the drawings will be available on the Thinklaser website, so you can take those drawings and make it fit your own machine. I'm certainly going to be leaving it attached to this machine because it can't do any harm. Whether it's going to do any good will be for other people to tell me. So until the next session, I'll say cheerio.